Every week, we've come to thoroughly enjoy this segment where we spend some time with the experts at Mercy Health. We learn about their area of expertise, hit them with some questions, make them regret having come on the show with us, but we walk away having learned something.
That's about right.
Works out very nicely for us. And, you know, if there's one thing that we say a lot off the air is, why do we not discuss otolaryngology more? Why don't we get in more otolaryngology?
We say it during every break.
Should we do.
Yeah, should we touch it now?
I think maybe we should probably finally get into all of that. And our expert from Mercy Health this morning is Dr. Faz Zahurullah. Dr. Zahurullah, good morning to you.
Good morning.
How are you this morning?
I'm very well. Thanks for having me.
We're glad to have you because this is a topic that we're interested in. And, you know, we know you're the one who's the expert here who will fill us in. But first, we need to know a little bit about you. Give us some background on yourself.
I grew up in the suburbs of Detroit. I moved to Rockford in 2000. After I finished my training, I went to med school and college at the University of Michigan. I did my residency in New York, and I've been in Rockford for 21 years. My family has grown up here, and we love it here.
Outstanding.
So you did your post-grad work at Michigan. That could be a problem here on the show, big Illinois fan. Where did we do the undergrad?
I went to Michigan for undergrad and med school.
Oh, boy.
You all right?
Just a Wolverine through and through.
Yeah, you going to be okay?
Well, they did. Yeah. They stole a Big Ten regular season title from Illinois this year.
But the doctor had nothing to do with any of those things.
I don't know. He contributed to it. Well, look, I'll let it slide.
I'm sorry to drag you into all of this, doctor, but it's just something we have to go through with every medical professional we encounter. Tell us a little bit about otolaryngology. What is that for the untrained ear out there?
Otolaryngology, sometimes it's also called otorhinolaryngology, has three separate parts to it. It's the study and treatment of diseases of the ears, nose, and throat. So those are Latin words. Oto is ears, rhino is the nose, and larynx is the throat. And so we are the medical and surgical doctors that manage all those areas.
Outstanding. And I've had quite a bit of experience with our oldest child when he was younger with ear tubes.
Yeah, so that's a common surgery. That's one of the most common surgeries done in the United States is ear tubes and also tonsils and adenoid surgery. Those are among the most common things that are done throughout the whole United States.
Are we still doing tonsils? Because when I was a kid, and, you know, I'm in my 50s at this point, but when I was a kid, it seemed like, you know, one out of two kids was getting tonsils yanked out.
There are some fluctuations in the practice patterns, but in general, it's still one of the most commonly done surgeries. We do this mostly in children, but also in adults. And the reasons that we take out the tonsils, for the most part, are either there are too many infections or the tonsils are so big that they're causing trouble with breathing or sleeping or swallowing.
How does a patient eventually end up in your office?
So I would say really two common ways to get into our office. One is they get referred from their primary care provider. If they found, and we see children and adults, we see men and women, we see people that are very healthy with small problems, and then unfortunately we see people that have big problems such as head and neck cancers. Those folks typically get referred to our office from their primary care provider. Sometimes they're referred from the emergency department or convenient care and walk-ins. So that's one of the, and for any of those problems that relate to the ear, nose, and throat. And then a sizable number of patients call directly. Either they have self-identified having a ear, nose, or throat problem. Sometimes it's because a family member has had a similar problem or has had an interaction with another otolaryngologist or ear, nose, and throat doctor, and so they self-referred, and we see many of those folks as well.
One of the topics we want to ask you about a little bit this morning is sinusitis. You hear that term a lot. You see it in advertising a lot. It's discussed a lot. What's the actual definition of sinusitis?
Sinusitis is defined as the inflammation of the sinuses and the sinus lining. Those are pockets inside the bone of the face. It has a wet lining, and those pockets can get blocked and infected. And then when they're blocked and infected, they cause a whole host of symptoms that are unpleasant and can even be dangerous.
I saw there's a trend going on the TikTok. I don't know if you're on TikTok, Doc. I'd stay away from it. But one of the tricks that was being shown on there was how to clear your sinuses, and that's always confused me. And you had a guy, you know, pushing around his nose and his cheek, and all of a sudden it was cleared up. Is that something you recommend trying to do? Is there a home remedy for clearing out your sinuses? What should we do there?
So massaging your face and nose is probably not very effective at really clearing your sinuses.
I am shocked TikTok lied to me.
I'm not on TikTok, but I don't think that's probably an effective way. But there are a lot of home remedies that are helpful if a patient is generally healthy and wants to maintain health. So, for example, in our area of the world where it's somewhat dry, particularly during winter months, a humidifier and saline spray, which is saltwater spray, can help to prevent overdrying of the nose, prevent nosebleeds and some of the discomfort that comes with that. And then there are a little bit more involved treatments that you can do at home called a sinus rinse or a neti pot, where we mix a controlled amount of salt in, ideally in distilled water or clean water. We don't really like to use tap water. And we literally flush out the nose. It sounds a lot worse than it is, but people that do it swear by it. And
I got to tell you, when you say that, doctor, I'm a huge neti pot guy. And going back about 3-4 years ago, it was recommended, and I started doing it. And like you just said, I thought, oh gosh, it's going to be gross, and am I going to drown myself here at the sink? It actually works pretty darn well, and I feel pretty good afterwards.
It's amazing. It was identified, you know, centuries ago, and it's such a simple remedy, and it really helps for a lot of people.
So neti pot officially gets a stamp of approval from a certified ear, nose, and throat doctor,
right? Yeah, I was
right?
going to ask, because if he was going to tell me, stop doing that immediately, I was going to stop doing it immediately. But I've gotten pretty good benefit out of it. But like you said, it's important that the water that you're using is clean, because I read some of the warnings on what happens if it's not, and you don't want that.
You don't want that. There's reports of organisms, including amoebas, that have been in contaminated water that ended up getting bad infections, so we don't want that.
Yeah,
you're putting that by your brain. You want to be careful.
Yeah, you want to avoid that.
You do want to be careful. What are some symptoms that maybe somebody's sitting on that they think might go away on its own, but does need to be looked at by somebody like you?
Yeah, great question. If you have a cloudy nasal discharge rather than clear, if it's causing facial pain above the eyes, below the eyes, between the eyes, if you can't breathe through your nose, if your smell is muffled or blunted, if you have a headache, chronic cough, teeth pain, and really bad breath, those by themselves could be a sign of sinusitis. If those symptoms last for 5 days and are getting worse or are not getting better after 7 days, that really means that you need to see a medical professional to check out that.
And it isn't one of those things that someone can go, well, you know, I see that there's a pollen alert out today. That's got to be it. There is a difference between the effect that those two things would have, right?
100%. And there's some really clear distinctions that we would help separate an infection or sinusitis from allergies that might be related to pollen, as you pointed out. Some of those are that in an infection, the drainage would more likely be cloudy, more like milk color, and an allergy would be more water color. In an infection, there'd typically be more pain and pressure, whereas with allergy, there might be itching and sneezing. And in an infection, you might more likely have fever and allergy. Ironically, even though that's called hay fever, you almost never have an actual fever.
Is that something that you would diagnose in your office is allergies as well?
We do make a clinical diagnosis of allergy, and then on occasion, depending on the circumstance, we would either do allergy testing or refer to an allergist. Allergy testing can be done through a blood test, and it can also be done through a skin test where you get small amounts of things that you might be allergic to put into your skin to see if you react.
I didn't know about the blood test. We've all seen
Doing it on your back?
The cardboard cutout with 70 holes in it.
Right.
Do that. Is the blood test just as effective as that scratch test?
So it's different. A blood test has some advantages. Certain medications would make a skin test not valid. You can't be on antihistamines, certain medications that could make skin testing dangerous, such as heart medications called beta blockers. Blood test is an effective way, but there is a reduction in sensitivity. What that means is sometimes skin tests can pick up an allergy that a blood test might not pick up. So depending on the circumstance, If possible, a skin test still might be preferable. In other circumstances where patients are on medications that would prevent a safe skin test, then a blood test is frequently done. And we do that frequently also in children that won't tolerate multiple pokes.
Oh, that makes sense. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, doctor, I guess everybody knows, has that person in their life or people in their life who are constantly have the snuffling going on, the I'm stuffed up, sneeze, that sort of thing, and just kind of believe, well, my dad had sinus problems, my grandpa had sinus problems, I got them. It's just kind of my lot in life. But they can come and see you and get some relief for this.
Absolutely. There are amazingly new and effective technologies that help us separate sinus issues and sinus infections from allergies and other similar symptoms such as migraines. And so first step would be to, even though your family members might have had sinus issues, to make sure that that's the correct diagnosis. And then another thing that's developed over the last 20 to 30 years is the treatments for sinus infections are far more effective and more sophisticated than what might have been a generation ago. People were somewhat scared about stories they've heard of how difficult sinus surgery was. Now, both our medical treatments are far more effective and sophisticated, and our procedural treatments, such as surgeries, are also far more effective.
So you really do not have to live with this problem that you've been suffering from.
Absolutely not. You do not need to live with those problems. If you have facial pain, cloudy discharge, headache, and if that's been lasting for more than 5 or 7 days, then it's very important that you could get treatment, feel better, and get back to a healthy, productive, and comfortable life.
Doctor, I have no doubt that that has piqued someone's interest, what was just said right there. For someone who is interested, how do they reach out to you?
They can call our office at 815-971-2800.
And that's all it takes. Make the call, make the contact. You don't have to, you know, you don't have to suffer through all of that. You don't have to, you know, keep the Kleenex company in business single-handedly. There are ways around this. Dr. Zahurullah, we really appreciate you taking time out of your day. This was highly educational, and we hope you'll come back and join us again on What's Up, Doc.
It was a pleasure. Thank you for having me.